Thank you very much, Sarita, for giving me an opportunity to talk to you guys. Living Science is doing a wonderful job of connecting with students who are interested in a career in science. And so it's very nice for me. It's an opportunity for me to talk about my experiences and also share some of my thoughts on AI. AI is my area of research, and you may have heard a lot about it, so I think it is going to be very timely. I'm going to talk about the past and where we are today and how the future is looking for us. Before I start, I should mention that my wife is also in the audience, and I'm rather nervous because this is the first time she's hearing my talk. So we'll see how it changes the discourse and family conversations later, but we'll see. Okay, so let's get started. I hope all of you have heard about AI, but many of you may not have heard about AI in a technical course. You may have heard about AI from popular media. In conversation like this, that conscious killer robots are going to enslave all the humans, or that, you know, this is a very weird headline that I saw. It almost feels like not a news article, but a story for a Hollywood movie. Or, you know, somebody actually wrote a very interesting article saying that suppose AI becomes our overlord, and AI should read this article so that it will find some reasons not to kill all humans. And Elon Musk obviously says that AI could doom human civilization, and so does Stephen Hawking. So what's going on? And there are some sane voices there in the middle which also bring out the point that Elon Musk is wrong, the AI is not going to kill us all, and in particular this particular survey of 50 Nobel laureates, and they are Nobel Prize winners, they probably know their stuff, have ranked climate, population rise, disease, and even Trump as bigger threats to humanity than AI. So this is one kind of discourse. The discourse is that AI is going to completely kill humans maybe a few years down the line. Okay. There's another kind of discourse which is at least a little bit closer to reality, or some part of reality, that someday it is possible that some of the robots are going to take some of our jobs. And of course, different people think of it at different levels of extremes. So this one particular article says that the world is going to sink into a hellish dystopia. Right. Of course, there are people who contradict this, saying that many jobs are safe from AI, but some people believe that many kinds of jobs might be eliminated at some point. Of course, at the same time, while some jobs may be eliminated, it will also create many more jobs, or it will at least this believes that it will create more jobs than it will eliminate, and it will create definitely new and unconventional career paths. So the world is evolving around us. The world is evolving somewhat rapidly right now, and I think it is important for all of us, irrespective of whether we are computer scientists or whether we are scientists or not, to really understand what is going on. What is AI? Why is there so much hullabaloo about it? What is its history? Where are we? And where is it going? And how does it affect us? So this talk is a talk meant to give my perspective on the issue, and this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to first start with really basics. This is sort of what I start teaching in my first class, in my first AI class. What is AI, right? It's actually a concept that people within AI also debate about very often. It's a philosophical issue. We'll talk a little bit about it, and then I'll explain how AI has come to this point. What happened in the history, how AI evolved, what were the various salient events that led us to today, and where are we? Right? Where have we reached, and where are we going, and how it's going to affect us? Right. So let's get started. AI stands for artificial intelligence. The artificial part is relatively easy. You know, we as humans are natural, and machine or table or anything like that is artificial. So the major question is, what does it mean for a machine, right, to be intelligent? That would be artificial intelligence. To understand that, we should ask the question, what is intelligence, right? And again, if you go to articles talking about what is intelligence, people debate this all the time. Philosophers disagree with each other, psychologists disagree with each other, people believe in and do not believe in IQ tests, people devise new tests. So it's actually by itself a complicated question. So if you go to dictionary, that itself, that definition also doesn't really help you. So for example, this is the dictionary.com definition. Intelligence is the capacity for learning, reasoning, understanding, and similar forms of mental activity. So in some sense, dictionary.com lists various things that could be considered intelligent, like learning and reasoning and understanding. But it gives us a hint of what else could be intelligence, basically forms of mental activity. Now, this is not surprising, because since ad infinitum, humans have believed who is intelligent? Humans are intelligent. Intelligence has been synonymously associated with humans. So therefore, it is not surprising that we would consider intelligence as some form of mental activity. But since we are making machines intelligent, we need to ask this question, are humans intelligent? Or are humans always intelligent? Do we not find some humans which we would not necessarily call intelligent? But at least from an AI point of view, since humans were always considered intelligent, replicating human behavior was an early hallmark of intelligence. If we could make a machine that does how humans do, we might call it artificially intelligent, right? Of course, humans are not always intelligent. We do not want to replicate all kinds of human behaviors. We know that humans are prone to jumping off the cliffs and, you know, hurting people and, you know, committing suicides and all of that, or feeling very angry in various circumstances. We don't want to build machines which feel the same way, right? So we all have shown our anger on Microsoft products once in a while, but if Microsoft showed its anger back, you will stop using it right away, right? So we need to also ask the question, can non-human behavior be intelligent? Are we going to limit ourselves to the behavior that humans have, or are we going to go beyond it or going to do something else? With this context, lots of people thought about different definitions of artificial intelligence. And if you look at the traditional textbooks on AI, and here I am showing you four different books, which are all defining AI in very different ways. And in fact, if we can summarize them, we can put them on a 2x2 grid like this, and this is the simpler forms of those definitions. An AI is a system that thinks like humans, or that acts like humans, so this is the human column, or that thinks rationally, or that acts rationally, that's the rationality column. Now we need to figure out which one do we like. Do we like human-like, or do we like rational? And similarly, do we want to build systems that only think, or do we want to build systems that act? And over time, people debated these definitions. For example, when you think about building a system which thinks like humans, it becomes a really hard task. How do you know how you think? Do you know how you think? Do you know what processes happen in your brain that allow you to think in a certain way? And definitely, it's not clear that when we are making a certain decision, we may be just making that decision emotionally. And then when you are asked, how did you make this decision? Then we come up with some post-facto rationalization. We don't want to build machines that, you know, take emotional decisions and then create some logic for why they took certain decisions. Similarly, systems that act like humans, that's actually a really interesting thought right there. In fact, this was the definition that Alan Turing provided very early on. In way back in 1950, when he thought about building machines, computers had just come up at that time, the World War had just ended. He thought about, can the machines think? And if the machines can think, how would I know? How can I know that somebody thinks? Forget a machine. The only way I can know that they think is by asking them questions, is by communicating with them, is by seeing how they act in the world, and then making a judgment on whether they are intelligent or not. Suppose I claimed that this table thinks. It is making some deductions inside in its wooden brain. It is proving a theorem. Can I ever know that this machine thinks, or this table thinks? I would never know that this table thinks, because the table has no way to communicate to us what it is thinking. Until you start to communicate to the world, until you start to act in the world, even if you are intelligent, it will be very hard for us to assess it. And therefore, in terms of a pragmatic operational definition of AI, just thought was not a very good idea. It was important to act. And there, Alan Turing said, well, how would I know that a machine thinks? I would do an experiment. This experiment, there would be a screen, and you would be communicating with something behind the screen, and the screen would be giving answers. And if we believe that the thing that we are interacting with behind the screen is a human and it turns out to be a machine, then I would know that the machine has reached human capabilities and therefore it is acting like humans and therefore it is intelligent. And this is the very famous Turing test that he devised. Of course, there are some issues with that test. First of all, just mimicking humans doesn't lead us very far. Humans, obviously, as we discussed, are not always intelligent. And moreover, this kind of test is not reproducible and so on. So therefore, later people went into rational thought as well as rational behavior, and as we discussed, thought itself isn't enough. So eventually, the definition of artificial intelligence became synonymous with systems that can act rationally.